One of the other questions I get is sort of how often do people trade? What do we see? How often are people trading? And we all have this idea that maybe we should be trading more than we are. You know, we should trade more. I should sell more often because I missed the peak. I should buy more often because I missed the low. If we have this idea that we should do more. On average, people don't trade very much. These are always, you know, these are large databases. So I should say this is all from the NABTrade database, and it's hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people. So some of those people will do absolutely nothing, and some of those people will do a lot. But on average, people trade once a month or less. That's largely where they sit. That's nearly 80% of our portfolio, 1 to 2 a month. And then there's a really small number of people who trade super actively. Also, things that should be noted, NABTrade is owned by a bank. There may be a tendency for more conservative people to want to trade with a platform owned by a bank. You're less likely to be looking for something that is, you know, on a separate app on your phone that gives you flowers every time you buy something or whatever. You might be naturally more conservative. I think there's one that gives you confetti when you place a trade. And so there may be a tendency for slightly more conservative behavior on our platform. But it's pretty consistent with the data that is available about what the overall investing community looks like. It's pretty evenly skewed by age, or pretty evenly distributed by age. It's pretty evenly distributed by wealth. And the skew in our book is exactly what you expect in the population, which is older people tend to be a lot wealthier and they hold more assets than younger people. Of course they do, because they've had more time to accumulate. So I'll get onto the bit that everyone's really interested in, which is what? What do people hold? And this is what people really own on NABTrade. As I said, it's hundreds of thousands of people, and they own NAB, which is weird. There's a really close correlation between being a NAB owner and having a NABTrade account. I actually don't know why. It's not staff, because we don't have to have our accounts with NABTrade. It's just, and I'm sure if you went to ComSec, it would be CBA, Daylight, and then everything else. We've got NAB, Daylight, and everything else. Probably don't pay too much attention to which bank is at the top, more the fact that 4 of the top 5 holdings on the platform are banks. We know this intuitively about retail investors, but the data is extremely clear. People love banks. They love banks. A lot of you in the room are older. People have loved holding banks. When I first started investing, the received wisdom was just buy banks. Just buy banks. You're going to make heaps of money. It's fine. Just buy banks. That has not been true for the last 7 years. Getting a big shake of the head. Like, it's not been true at all. Banks have drifted down terribly. Apart from CBA, NAB shares, even though they've had a nice little run lately, are still well below where they were pre-GFC. So there have been plenty of opportunities to do better in things other than banks, but the yield and the dividend is just way too attractive for a lot of retail investors. And I think there's also a very strong security element. People feel that banks are not going to go underwater. They're going to keep paying. They're going to be around. They got through the GFC. They got through COVID. They're going to be here and they're going to pay me. So people love banks and they keep loving banks even when they're not doing well. They love banks. CSL is number 6. So BHP is number 3. As I mentioned earlier, it is the largest share, the largest company on the ASX by a very reasonable margin now, primarily because of that delisting from the London Stock Exchange. So you find yourself in an interesting scenario with BHP where if you are a fund manager, you are probably very underweight BHP. Everybody's underweight BHP, unless it's like the biggest thing you hold. So there's a lot of BHP in there, but not as much as the market. And CSL is there at number 6. Anyone here own CSL for more than 10 years? The hand went down. Yeah, everyone here. You've had a great time. It did make it close to $350, but it's just been an extraordinary powerhouse of a share. And I have a little soft spot for it because it was the second thing I ever bought. And then I sold it like an idiot and didn't hold it all the way through. But CSL's in there because people have held it for a really, really long time. What's interesting about CSL, for those who haven't followed the story, right? So It was at $15 20 years ago. It's now at $267 from last memory. It's been as high as $350. It's come back. It's doing this massive transaction with a company called Vifor. But it's an extraordinary Australian success story. And the reason it's so high in our numbers is because people bought it a long time ago and held it. But we have suddenly started to see a real explosion in holders because people saw it come back. And they wanted to buy it earlier, but it was too expensive. People do not like expensive stocks on the NabTrade platform. Okay, so what are they also buying? ETFs. If you asked me 2 years ago, I would say no, ETFs are not a big thing for us. They were 4% of our book, 4% of turnover, not very interesting. They're now closer to 10%. There were ETFs in our top 10 buys during COVID, and there are now ETFs in our top 10 buys pretty much every week. And absolutely, when the market pulls back, which is a lot at the moment, as you know, the days when it's down 1.5%, that Vanguard ETF, the ASX 200, will be in the top five. What is most interesting about that is that I am frequently asked why it's not an international ETF. We know that Australian investors have a really strong home bias. They're really concentrated in Australian equities. Why aren't they buying the S&P 500? I don't know. They just buy the ASX 200, that's what they want. Couple of reasons probably is it's usually people's first investment. And if you're making your first investment, it's much more comforting to buy your own home shares and stuff you know reasonably well than it is to buy offshore. Buying offshore has changed in that you know what Apple is. You probably have one of their products in your pocket or in your home. You know what Tesla is. You see people drive them. Like, you actually do have experience of international companies in a way that you didn't have 20 years ago. So 20 years ago, you'd be like, I don't know what Wells Fargo is. Apparently, it's a bank. You literally didn't know what the companies did, and you certainly didn't have any personal experience of them, whereas now the biggest companies in the world are absolutely in your home and in your life, and so you have a much better and more tangible experience, and you're more likely to buy them, but you're still much more likely to buy BHP or NAB, particularly NAB, apparently. Younger investors and women also show a greater preference for ETFs than older investors and guys, partly because they're just a great way to take the decision-making out of buying. You know, for a lot of investors, I want to invest, I don't know what, an ETF just solves that problem for me. Once you've picked one, you just go with it, keep going with it, and that seems to be a great process for a lot of people. I think there's a significant barefoot investor effect as well. Anyone here follow the barefoot investor? We've got a smile over here. People love that guy. They love him. And you know, that is, it's taken a lot of the pressure off people, the mental load of trying to decide what. You don't have to psych yourself out anymore. You just buy that and go with it. International, as I said, it's become much easier to buy international equities than it was a decade ago. On NabTrade, you can buy US, UK, Germany, and Hong Kong. So you can buy four international markets directly. You have to buy them during open hours, so you need to stay up late or put your trade on and then wait for it to fill while you're asleep. But you can do it, and it's exciting, and your brokerage is the same as your Australian brokerage. It's like $14.95 if you're up to $5,000 or whatever it is. Is everybody buying international? Nope. It's a meaningful proportion of our base, but it's nothing like 50%. It's much, much less than that. And if you're going to buy something, it's probably Tesla. The Elon Musk effect is insane. People love that company and they just keep buying it. And the sort of value of putting up both the number of account holders and the value, if you were just seeing the growth in the value of Tesla shares, because obviously they've been on an extraordinary tear, they've come back about 30%, but you know, the growth is crazy, right? Up over 1,000%. You would not see as many account holders, but you see a lot of account holders and a lot of value held in Tesla. People love it. Every day I come in, you look at the numbers and they've been buying Tesla overnight. It doesn't seem to be a strong correlation with the share price. This is just about wanting to hold that stock. So great love for Tesla, followed by Apple, then Microsoft, and you can see the tail really sharply comes down, right? So it's a long tail of small things. This is what they are doing if they're not sitting in cash or trimming, and we have seen some trimming lately. Materials are huge at the moment, and that has been a rotation. 2 years ago, 3 years ago, BHP was in the top 10 during COVID, but it was the only one. And there just was not a lot of interest. Fortescue only made it into our numbers about 18 months ago when the iron ore price was hitting $220 a ton, which was extraordinary. And people have learned to trade that stock really actively because it plays really nicely on your charts if that's your thing. So Fortescue is huge at the moment for traders who really follow the market very closely. That's a daily trade. And lithium stocks, oh my God, who's been buying lithium stocks? Yep, everyone, right? Everyone's buying lithium. The reason I say retail investors are pretty astute is that is not a particularly new trend for us. We saw a hell of a lot of buying of lithium last year and quite a bit the year before as well if it was Pilbara Minerals. So this is not, it's not unheard of. We've just had people really riding it through recently and the range of names is expanding. But it'll be interesting to see when that stops. Financials. Macquarie is very popular, under $180. People love Macquarie, and they want to see, it have a run again, and they're happy to buy it on some weakness. Magellan Financial Group, so that is MFG. Magellan's had an absolutely horrific run, absolutely dreadful, and investors have seen it fall from great heights. And some people have been buying it on the way down. It's now sub $20. It's been very painful if you owned anywhere through that period. But we're seeing people buy it and sell it now in a pretty tight range. That is quite interesting, and I wonder if it will continue. Energy. Lots of reasons to trade energy. We saw a heap of buying in oil stocks. We saw buying in the oil ETF back when oil futures turned negative. Does anyone remember this? There's a brief window, like overnight, when oil futures turned negative in the middle of COVID, when suddenly no one wanted oil anymore. There were no planes in the sky. No one was driving. Energy is obviously very popular with prices where it is right now. So Woodside's the big favorite. Not a lot of interest in Santos. The other thing you will notice, ethical ESG related stuff, not big on the NAB trade platform. We're not big on ESG, apparently. That's not a strong trend that we see, unless you're talking Tesla, which is that transition story. It's an Elon Musk story. It's a meme stock story. There's a lot of things going on with Tesla. It is a very, very consistent buy. What we are not seeing, buy now, pay later. Zip, Afterpay were both in the top 10 2 years ago. Most people got out of Afterpay before that block transition happened, and there has just been almost no interest since, which was obviously something that's played out quite well for people. Zip was a trading stock for a while. It's gone. It's not there at all. We are not seeing buying the dip in tech. Not in Australia anyway. People are just not interested. They don't want to touch it. So we don't see those numbers really coming through very strongly. Xero got a bit of interest. Their results got absolutely hammered. We saw a bit of interest, but not a great deal. Gaming, I said ESG is not huge on the platform, but one thing that people do not buy much of is anything gaming related. It's just not huge. And there's a lot of concern about the former darlings and the idea that you might be catching a falling knife. We're not seeing dip buying that you would expect in a market when the ASX has effectively given back 12 months worth of gains. We're not seeing people see this as the buying opportunity of a lifetime. We're seeing people stay pretty calm. They're waiting and they're only buying quality.